Good Sunday morning, friends. It's good to be together in spirit and worship the Lord on this morning. Gary and I are here coming to you from the church library, locked, hidden in here from the rest of the world, just as the disciples were on that first Easter afternoon. As we prepare our hearts for worship, I ask you to consider this. Paul urged the believers in Rome to present their bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Let us worship God. Thank you.
nails in your hand, the nail in your feet. They tell me how much you love me. The thorns in your brow, they tell me how you bore so much shame to love me. And when the heavens pass away, all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me. So I want to say, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. It's yours. The nails in your hand, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. Thorns in your brow, they tell me how you bore so much shame to love me. And when the heavens pass away, all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me. So I want to say, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. And when the heavens pass away, all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say how much you love me. So I want to say, forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. Forever my love, forever my heart, forever my life is yours. It's yours. It's yours.
God speaks to us through the prophet Jeremiah, saying, "Call on me and I will answer you." Let us pray. Amazing God, we come before you in awe of what you have done in Christ Jesus. We believe and we have doubts. We do good and we sin. We are imperfect humans and still beloved by you. Assured of your grace and power, we are ready to grow again. We yearn for a new way, a new perspective, and a clear path. Sometimes we get carried away by fear, by wishful thinking, and by popular trends that pull us in. Lord, move us beyond mere trust in ordinary things and open our eyes for spiritual realities. We pray today especially for a dramatic turn for the better as the world fights this virus. Give our leaders your wisdom as to how to proceed. Give our healthcare professionals the extra energy to do what they are being called to do. Give those who are isolated the assurance that you are with them every single minute. Help us to care about and for each other more. May the way Christ Church lives and acts, helps and heals, be a witness to the world of your great power and love. Speak to us today, Lord God, by the power of your Spirit. Inspire our hearts, enlighten our minds, guide our actions because of what you have done in Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our gospel reading for this morning comes from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. Jesus appears to the disciples. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. When he had said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the disciples told him, We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. A week later, the disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, here we are, friends, having not been together for a month, and I hate it. I'm an extrovert, and this time is really hard for me. On most days, I do pretty well, though. I trust in the Lord with all my heart. I know that God is working in all this for our good. I believe that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, our God is with us. I see blessings every single day that confirm that we have not been abandoned to disease, destruction, or despair. But occasionally, I get sad or mad or crazy silly. I get frustrated and impatient. I feel helpless and even hopeless the longer this goes on and the more things that are canceled. And then, in the providence of God, we come to the story of Thomas. I remember a cartoon about Thomas. He is complaining to Jesus about his nickname, Doubting Thomas. He tells Jesus, no one calls Peter denying Peter. And Jesus tells Thomas he's just going to have to deal with it. To be forever known as Doubting Thomas would be a reputation that is hard to live with. And Thomas didn't doubt forever. He doubted for only a week until he saw Jesus for himself. Thomas just needed what all the other disciples had received, a chance to see it for himself. You know, doubt is not necessarily a bad thing. The great preacher Harry Emerson Fosdick, in his sermon, The Importance of Doubting Our Doubts, pointed out that the capacity to doubt is one of humanity's noblest traits. There are many practices and beliefs which ought to be doubted. Great people, he wrote, are distinguished by the fact that in the face of universally accepted falsehoods, they dared stand up and cry, I doubt that. Without the capacity to doubt, there could be no progress, only docile, unquestioning acceptance of the status quo and its established dogmatisms. Every scientific advance has started with skepticism. Doubters are often proven right. We also find that great faith comes out of a struggle with doubt. We can inherit Christian faith, swallowing it without question, continuing in the tradition of our parents and grandparents as a habit. But that habit will eventually give way to something else because the faith is not really ours. Great faith, if it is to be one's own, has to be fought for. Scripture is filled with those who question, struggle, and fight for faith. Listen to Gideon crying, If the Lord is with us, why has this befallen us? Listen to the psalmist, My tears have been my food day and night, while they continually say to me, Where is thy God? Listen to the man with the epileptic son begging, I believe, help my unbelief. Listen to Saul breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. And listen to Thomas insist, Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will never believe. So, what brought Gideon and David, a hurting father, Saul, now Paul, and Thomas to faith? They saw enough evidence to doubt their doubt. They disbelieved their disbelief. They came to the point where the evidence was just so overwhelming that it became irrational to doubt any longer. The evidence which Thomas demanded and which Jesus gave were his scars. Isn't it interesting that Jesus didn't say, look at my face, you can tell it's me, or watch this miracle. He said, look at my hands and my side. Why is this the evidence we demand and the evidence Jesus gives? Well, I believe Jesus' hands and feet and side show that he is really the man who was crucified, dead, and buried. He has wounds to prove it in his body. The resurrected Jesus still has a body. He is not a ghost. He remains a flesh and blood human being, fully human, fully God. But there are some differences about Jesus now. He can travel at light speed from place to place. He can walk through closed doors. He can appear and then disappear. How cool is that? In his life, death, and resurrection, Jesus showed us a new humanity. In his life, he had an intimate relationship with God the Father, which flowed out of him to help and heal us. In his death, he showed a shocking solidarity with sinners and with all who suffer physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And now resurrected, he shows us what is promised, a glorified humanity to match the magnificent spirit which resides in him and in us. In our resurrection, we will not be susceptible to disease. We may not have to ever diet again, but we will have a body. We say we believe in the resurrection of the body because Jesus was resurrected with a body. I also believe that Jesus' hands and feet and side show us that his love and grace and help are real. His scars are present and will for all eternity remind us that his love for us is real, proven by his willingness to go through what he went through. The hands Jesus shows us are so that we will focus on these hands that broke and fed over 5,000 people. Those hands pressed mud into a blind man's eyes and made him see. Those hands touched lepers. Those hands picked up children and blessed them. Those hands were pierced by Roman nails. Jesus' feet walked the dusty roads of Galilee and Judea. Those feet were washed with tears and dried with the hair of an immoral woman. Those feet went out of their way to find a demoniac in a Gerasene cemetery. Those feet brought good news wherever they trod. Those feet carried a heavy Roman cross and were pierced with a Roman nail. By looking at Jesus' hands and feet, those who follow him remember what he has done, what he stands for, and that it was all done out of love, costly love, because he valued us more than he valued himself. Therefore, we are all, each of us, of infinite worth. It's Jesus' wounds that finally convince Thomas and us that he is for real. It is his sacrifice that starts us to doubting our doubts. The evidence is overwhelming. Upon seeing them, Thomas cries, "My Lord and my God." And he doubts no more. Tradition says he went to India to preach the good news of Jesus Christ and was martyred there. And finally, I believe Jesus also wants to see his hands and feet and remember his death so that we don't run away from the problems in our world, but are willing to give ourselves to help the suffering of others. In his wounds, we see that sacrifice for others is what Jesus is all about. All the disciples in the room that afternoon will be called to give themselves so that others may know Christ and live. Michael Card tells the story of Joseph, a tall, slender Maasai warrior. I read it every year around this time for what I think will be obvious reasons when you hear it. His story begins with him walking along a hot, dusty African road. He met someone who shared the good news of Jesus Christ with him. He accepted Jesus as Savior and Lord, and the power of the Spirit began transforming his life. He was filled with such excitement and joy that the first thing he wanted to do was return to his own village and share this good news with members of his tribe. Joseph began going door to door, telling everyone he met about the cross of Jesus and the salvation it offered, expecting to see their faces light up just the way his had. To his amazement, the villagers not only did not care, but they became hostile. The men of the village seized him and held him down, while the women of the village beat him with strands of barbed wire. He was dragged from the village and left to die alone in the bush. Joseph somehow managed to crawl to a watering hole, and there, after 2 days of passing in and out of consciousness, found he had the strength to get up. Still, he wondered about the hostile reception he received from these people he had known all his life. He decided he must have left something out of the story or told it wrong. After rehearsing the message he first heard, he decided to go back to the village and share his faith once more. Joseph limped back into the circle of huts and began again to proclaim the good news about Jesus. He died for you so that you might find forgiveness and come to know the living God, he pleaded. Once again, he was grabbed by the men of the village and held while the women beat him a second time, opening up wounds that had just begun to heal. Once more, they dragged him unconscious from the village and left him to die. For a third time, he returned to this small village. This time, he found everyone waiting for him. Before he could even open his mouth, they attacked him. As they began to flog him for the third and probably the last time, he began again to speak to them of Jesus Christ, the Lord, who had power to forgive sin and give new life. The last thing he remembers before he passed out was some of the women who were beating him begin to weep. This time he awoke in his own bed, not in the wilderness. The very ones who had so severely beaten him were now trying to save his life and nurse him back to health. The entire village had come to Christ. We know Joseph's story because he shared it with Billy Graham. And then he lifted his shirt to show the scars that covered his chest and back. He thanked Mr. Graham for listening to his story, and then he walked away. Graham was heard to respond, "I am not worthy to untie his shoes." It was Joseph's willingness to be wounded and killed that led his village to faith in Jesus. The way that we who have believed witness to the sacrifice of Jesus is to sacrifice ourselves, to carry, as Paul says, the marks of Jesus in our body, to present our bodies as living sacrifices. I need to be clear here. This is not a call to endure an abusive relationship. This is a call to willingly decide to give all we have and all we are for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just as Jesus is, his church will be known by its scars of sacrifice. In a world that values material wealth and rejects the idea of personal sacrifice, even to a church that lifts up material wealth as a sign of Christ's presence and belittles service in favor of personal fulfillment, the scars of Jesus speak volumes. Look at your own hands and feet. If we are Christ's body, what do our hands and feet reveal about Jesus' own sacrifice? How many times do our hands fold in prayer? How often do our hands reach into our pockets and share what we have for the work of the church or the help of the poor? How many times have our hands lovingly folded around another's to say, "You are not alone"? When have our feet walked with a young child as a mentor? When have our feet run to another in need? How have our feet become sore and tired working for God's kingdom? I've seen many hands and feet putting up and tearing down countless tables of hospitality and food, writing cards, hugging, cooking and serving meals, sewing, making calls, hosting funeral receptions, driving others to doctor's appointments or the store, loving the unlovable, running to help those in need. We've seen many examples during this pandemic. Many Christians are busy, rough, and dirty. And that, my friends, is our witness. But some are idle, well manicured, and too soft to testify to Jesus. The world will be overwhelmed and convinced that Jesus is alive not by selfish Christians, but by those who imitate his freely given sacrifice. John says he wrote this account of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection so that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ. If you have some doubt, that's okay. But don't be so stuck in your doubt that you refuse to see the evidence of loving sacrifice right in front of you. There's evidence of Christ's sacrifice all around you in his body, the church. What has someone else given for you? What has someone else given up for you? I pray you see some of the evidence in me. If you do, don't be afraid to doubt your doubts, to disbelieve your disbelief, and to cry with Thomas, "My Lord and my God." Amen.
I can see waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. I can hear all God's people singing now. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power rose Jesus from the grave. The same power that commands the dead to wake lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks. The same power that can calm the raging sea lives in us, lives in us, lives in us, lives in us. We have hope that his promises are sure. In his strength there is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave. The same power that commands the dead to wake lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks. The same power that can calm the raging sea lives in us, lives in us, lives in us, lives in us. That is living in me. He's conquered our enemy. No power of darkness, no weapon prepared. We stand here in victory. And greater is he that is living in me. He's conquered our enemy. Darkness, no weapon prepared. We stand here in victory. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave. The same power that commands the dead to wake lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks. The same power that can calm the raging sea lives in us, 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 lives in us. Thank you.
Now unto the God who loved us enough to lay down his life for us in Christ Jesus, be all honor and glory and power. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.